local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Well, good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome. Today is Thursday. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad, and let us also be thankful for a gorgeous morning. Wow.
Yeah, it's a little dark right now, but man, I couldn't believe how warm it was when I walked outside this morning.
Just yeah, 64 fabulous. Degrees right now, heading to 76 today.
Oh my God.
So cloudy and warm
Let me remind you, this October 26th. And I was walking around yesterday evening, and I thought, my goodness, we're not that far from very cold temperatures.
Mm-hmm.
And yet here we are in short sleeves. And today, I mean, you could even justify putting on shorts today if you want. I mean, it's just beautiful. Mm-hmm. 76 degrees yeah. on October the 26th.
Near 80 tomorrow.
Isn't that crazy?
That's right. So, and then we're going to be, mid-50s and then upper 40s. But, we'll take today and tomorrow for sure.
It does appear to me that they should move trick-or-treat up a couple days, because by Tuesday, when trick-or-treating is happening in most of our neighborhoods, it's 40s.
Don't go messing with Halloween.
But you have to admit, it's probably more comfortable for the kiddos.
Oh, yeah.
In the 40s or 50s, 70s, 80s might be a little hot in those outfits. So maybe it's more appropriate. But yeah. I would bet they would choose the 50s, 60s over
the
40s.
Absolutely.
But guess what, kids? Life is tough. That's just the way it is. Get used to it.
That's right.
It's not fair.
So, a lot going on, a lot to cover.
And
a
get
lot
off
to,
my lawn.
A lot to pray about today.
Yeah.
And, we see, obviously,
oh my goodness.
Conflicts continuing there in the Middle East.
And, yeah.
It's good to see a delay, or at least a scaling back of the ground invasion. And
waiting for the United States to get its defensive pieces in place.
Absolutely. And just horrible news out of Lewiston, Maine, where an active shooter began late yesterday. And now, as of this morning, that shooter's still at large. They're still looking for him. At least 20 people dead and up to 60 injured. And they fear that the death toll will go higher because he had a high-power automatic weapon. And he's got training in that. In fact, he's a firearms instructor. Robert Card is his name. They've got a clear picture of him from a surveillance video. He's 40 years old and considered armed and dangerous. The law enforcement officials in Maine say that he's a certified firearms instructor and a member of the Army Reserve, and obviously struggling with mental issues. He was institutionalized over the summer. He was hearing voices.
Right.
It's
self-reported.
Just amazing. Yeah.
I mean, he went for help saying, yes. I'm hearing voices. And obviously, he is showing signs of severe mental struggle.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to wonder, I mean, one, we don't know about the care.
Right.
But then two, is it really good at that point to continue to let someone have a gun? We've got to, look, people are so sensitive about these gun laws. We have to do some common sense things. When you're having a mental breakdown and you've expressed or shown signs of mental illness, we should probably, not
confiscate
probably,
those guns.
We should confiscate the guns
and,
at that
you
point.
Know, when you're a certified firearms instructor, who knows what access you had before you had mental issues that might still be in the home or, obviously they've got a certain knowledge that others don't have, and maybe they have more resources to acquire these things. I don't know. It's very sad, but... at least two locations, probably three locations. I think there was a Walmart distribution center and a bowling alley and a bar restaurant that he really just randomly shot people.
Yeah, and we've got to pray for these folks. And look, I've never been to Lewiston that I'm familiar with, but I've been to Portland, which is just 20 miles away. So this is the incredible thing. Last year in Maine, in the state of Maine, there were 25 murders.
Mm-hmm.
In the entire state for the entire year.
Right.
This sits at 22 and possibly growing.
Yeah.
So you could see the shock that would be present among the people there. And he's still at large.
Yeah. And obviously with his training, knows where to hide, and how to evade. So that's a very scary situation. So we continue to pray for them to find. And really, you've got Portland and you've got others, police and sheriffs. there's a huge manhunt underway. That's a lockdown area there.
And with his training, obviously that adds to the danger of the situation. So we pray for the repose of the souls of the 22 and counting possibly, and for their families, for an end to him being at large, that they would be able to find him and arrest him and end this violence and make sure that no additional individuals are killed or wounded. That's our prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Pray for law enforcement, for their wisdom, for their own protection, and for the protection of all the people who are in harm's way right now.
Amen. And I want to congratulate our political body there in Washington that took my advice yesterday about musical chairs.
They did.
For the new Speaker of the House, and now we have a new Speaker of the House.
Yeah, and I think that we could have done that first. You know what I mean?
I think so, yeah, absolutely.
They said, well, let's go with this leader and that leader, and none of those worked until they got the musical chairs involved. Bam! That worked every time. Learn from the second graders.
That's right. I'm just telling you.
If you want a problem solved, you go to a second grade teacher. Mrs. Holden would be mine, but she is now of happy memory. But that is someone who was wise could be, my second grade teacher, and I would often go back to her, and I would ask her questions, and then she would say, who are you? I don't remember you. You know how many students I've had? I'm like, yeah, I thought I was your favorite. She's, yeah, I don't think so.
And then, of course, there's my third grade teacher.
Just because you sat next to my desk doesn't make you my favorite, by the way.
Who was crazy and probably should have been a world leader because she would have straightened things out. Because if she saw me misbehaving or anybody else for that matter, she would quietly walk over to our desk and grab a handful of hair on our head.
Yeah.
And shake
physically.
Yeah
probably can't do that anymore.
You got hair laying all over your desk and everything. It's like, okay, well, I ain't doing that again. Whatever it was. But Representative Mike Johnson is a 51-year-old Louisiana Republican. Not many people familiar with him. He's only been really in politics for about 7 years,
but got a unanimous vote from the Republicans.
Well, 220 to 209. Yeah, so he only needed 217 votes and he got 220, so we finally have that. And I love the fact, he's conservative, and he is a practicing Christian, very vocal about it. He says the Bible is very clear that God is the one that raises up those in authority. He says, I believe each one of us has a huge responsibility today to use the gifts that God has given us to serve the extraordinary people of this great country. So, he is answering to a higher power.
There were 12 members who voted to make that unanimous vote possible, and they were asked later about that fact, saying, well, it's good, even though he got all the votes, all the Republican votes, and thank you for participating in the unanimous vote. And 12 of them said, I thought it was anonymous. No, it's unanimous. Yeah. And those are two different things.
That's right.
And 12 of them went, oh my goodness, I had no idea. But in any case, it got done.
That's right.
And we are thankful because, look, there are big things. As much as we might jest and have fun, we need leadership in place. So we're thankful for that.
Yeah, and it's about time. My goodness, it took way too long to do that.
But at the end of the day, we might have gotten the right guy. You know, like there's no way he is the one who rises to the top without going through all of this. Mm-hmm. We don't know that. It may be a disaster. But what if it turns out to be absolutely fabulous and you couldn't have gotten there unless you went through all of
this? Right.
So we don't know. We can't proclaim that. But he certainly seems like a good guy. And hopefully he'll get the job done.
Yeah, and I'm sure Wendy will cover this in the news, too. But it looks like Ford UAW have reached an agreement.
That would be great.
This could be the beginning of the end of this long strike.
Yeah, and we pray that that is the case because obviously once that domino falls, the other dominoes will fall pretty quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, we pray that, that comes about as well. Could be a very good day. Hey, we're going to be going into news and today in history and all that, but I want to tell you there's a news story out there that I can't wait to get to, and we're not going to cover it right now, but we're going to get to it. Pope requests youngest synod member be excused from classes. I can't wait to cover this story from Vatican News. It is both intriguing and funny and gives you a little peek into the synod on synodality as well.
Can't wait to hear that story every day. That'll be fun.
Yeah, so we'll talk about that a little bit later.
Very good. Let's see here. Yeah, a big day ahead, a big Thursday ahead. Let's find out what's happening all around the area here. It's Wendy with the news.
Good morning, Wendy.
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning in the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio. I'm Wendy Sheridan. A public meeting tonight to talk about a possible apartment complex in South Toledo. The development is called The Glen. It would bring a 50-unit building to Glendale and Bern as part of the Southland Shopping Plaza. In the past, neighbors have taken issue with a potential project, saying they'd prefer to see businesses there. The meeting is tonight at the Heather Downs Branch Library. Metro Parks Toledo will soon add a new inclusive playground. Board members voted unanimously to add ADA-compliant equipment at Ravine Park. The price tag, a little more than $88,000. The area will be renamed the Ravine Area of Glass City Metro Park. A deadly mass shooting shocked the state of Maine last night. Authorities say a gunman shot dozens of people, many fatally, in multiple locations in Lewiston, Maine. A state police bulletin said a man identified as a person of interest is a firearms instructor trained by the military and was recently committed to a mental health facility. The United Nations warns it is close to running out of fuel in the Gaza Strip. The UN says that would force it to sharply scale back relief efforts in the territory devastated by Israeli airstrikes. That happened since Hamas's gruesome attack on Israel on October 7th. In Washington, D.C., Republicans finally came together to elect a Speaker of the House. Mike Johnson, a lawmaker from Louisiana, garnered the required 217 votes to take the gavel, something three other nominees failed to do after Kevin McCarthy was ousted from the Speaker position. The United Auto Workers and Ford have reached a tentative deal 6 weeks into the auto workers' strike. The agreement must be voted on and approved by Ford's more than 50,000 UAW employees. It includes a 25% wage increase over the next 4 years and better retirement benefits. The other two automakers, General Motors and Stellantis, are also continuing to work towards agreements with the unions. This week, Apple is raising the price of its subscription rates for Apple TV Plus and other services. Apple TV Plus subscribers will now pay $9.99 a month, $3 more than the previous price. This is the second price hike for Apple TV Plus since its 2019 launch. The price of Halloween candy is downright scary. Candy prices are up 7.5% compared to last year. Americans are expected to spend $3.6 billion on Halloween candy this year. That's about $32 per person. From the WTOL 11 Weather Center, cloudy 75 today, sunny 77 tomorrow, clouds return 66 for Saturday. More seasonable temperatures are coming our way next week. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan.
Gee, thanks, Wendy.
Thank you, Wendy. Hey, I've got a quick question here.
Yes.
Today, look, a whole lot going on. But in history, what happened on this date?
Good question.
In history.
I know who knows.
Good morning, Mr.
I'm looking
Producer
for
Tim.
No, I know. All right. And 1825, we go back. After some 8 years of construction, the Erie Canal, which connects the Great Lakes with New York City by the Hudson River at Albany, officially opened, successfully propelled New York City into a major commercial center and encouraged canal construction throughout the U.S.
Wow, that's pretty historic.
Yeah, I was going to say, we had our own.
Yeah. We could take that for granted, but it was a huge moment. 1881, a feud between the Earp brothers, Wyatt, Virgil, and Morgan, and an outlaw gang led by Ike Clanton escalated into a celebrated gunfight at the OK Corral in Tombstone, Arizona.
Wow. We call it a celebrated gunfight?
Well, that's what they wrote. So
I don't celebrate anybody celebrating.
In the lens of history.
Lots of people died in that thing. Yeah.
I think it's historical. It was honored. Yeah.
Remembered.
Remembered.
Did anybody know that Wyatt Earp had brothers? I didn't know that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Wyatt and Virgil. I mean,
Wyatt lived well into his 90s. When I lived in Dodge City, he would have been the sheriff there.
Wow.
And he lived well into his 90s.
And I don't want to assume this, but I would think that at least there's a possibility because you have Wyatt, Virgil, and then the youngest brother, Morgan. And I would assume that somehow Morgan is related to Morgan Freeman, right? I mean, so he's probably like his great-great-grandfather or something.
I wonder.
There's an interesting bit of trivia.
Yeah.
I think one of them died in that. I think the younger yeah. one died in that OK Corral gunfight. 1970, following an absence of more than 3 years, American boxer Muhammad Ali returns to the ring. He had been barred after he refused to be inducted into the U.S. Army during the Vietnam yeah. War. One other sports note, 1986, and I interviewed him once, but I was told not to ask about that famous heir, Bill Buckner. His heir dooms Red Sox, forcing Game 7. Eventually, the Mets win the World Series.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's my one regret in broadcasting. I didn't ask him about that because later on, I saw him at QVC, and he was signing on the memorabilia. Oops.
Oh, oops.
Yeah. Well, I should have asked him. Yeah. All right. Well, celebrity birthdays, Pat Sajak, 77. Keith Urban, country singer, 56. National Chicken Fried Steak Day, National Pumpkin Day. I don't know why they don't make that October 31st. And National Howl at the Moon Day. Ooh. So if you go outside and howl at the moon, and the neighbors think you're just crazy, just say, hey, it's National Howl at the Moon Day.
And they'll still think you're crazy. So it's okay.
It's perfectly fine.
You're supposed to howl the full moon, not just, you know, not just partial moon. But anyway, that's the look at today in history.
Day in history.
It's actually been quite a day in history.
I like it. And now today is Thursday. On Thursdays at 4:30 p.m. for the last 9 years, and even before that, but for the last 9 years, we've had our program, The Bishop's Corner, hosted by Bishop Daniel Thomas. Now we've started this new segment on Morning Offering where the bishop himself picks a question from today's program, today's 4:30 p.m. program, and we highlight it on Morning Offering.
That's right. Ron Miller is asking him the question, and I think it's about prayer.
Thomas in Swanton, dear Bishop Thomas.
Thank you, Thomas.
We hear often about the persistence of prayer in the parable of the unjust judge. I often pray and pray for a particular intention that I feel will bring me closer to God, and yet the prayer has gone unanswered. Are there any examples that inspired you in having patience for making a particular intention that you could impart to me that will keep me encouraged when I feel God isn't listening to me? Thanks, Thomas.
Thomas, you bring up a spiritual question that every person watching, listening, and this bishop have experienced personally and spiritually, right? I prayed for it, but it didn't come. Now, I can tell you, Thomas, you know, all the great spiritual writers say, whenever you pray, Lord, you know, I would like you to do this. I would like you to do that. It should always be added to, if it be your holy will. So I think there's a careful distinction. And trust me, Thomas, the Lord knows what we want before we even open our mouths, right? But we know from all the great saints, it simply may be that he's depriving us of this thing. For example, if he won't take away this illness, if he won't remove this thorn in our side, if he won't change this difficult situation, it may be that his will is that we literally suffer through it to be strengthened in grace as a result of the illness, the relationship, or the difficult challenge. So I think be careful, you know, because you say, when I feel God isn't listening, guess what, Thomas? God is always listening. Just because you don't get what you want doesn't mean he's not listening. Let me give you some examples. Saint Monica prayed ceaselessly for the conversion of her son for 17 years before it happened. Saint Rita persevered in prayer for the conversion of her husband and the salvation of her sons. Catherine of Siena prayed, fasted, cared for the poor and sick, made mortification for the healing of the church to the point where she went to talk to the Pope. Padre Pio teaches us, listen to his wonderful words, pray, hope, and don't worry. That's Padre Pio. Prayer is the best weapon we have. It's the key to God's heart, he says. St. John Paul II, look at his experience in life, having grown up under communism, suffered the death of his parents and siblings, witnessed so much evil during the Nazi regime of Poland. And imagine, who could imagine that his prayers at that time, I imagine he prayed in a way, you know, free us from this. Who could have imagined that the Iron Curtain would have fallen of communism during his time as Pope? So if you haven't received it, it may not be perhaps the Lord's will now, and it may come in the future in a manner much more in line with his will than you could ever, ever imagine.
All right. Thanks, Bishop.
Thank you, Thomas.
That's a wonderful question. And what a great answer. And that's only one. There's four more questions that the bishop took on this week's Bishop's Corner. Again, airing for the first time, you just heard something that you're not going to hear, and nobody's really going to hear until 4:30 this afternoon.
And I mean, I think we're so used to Bishop Thomas that we don't realize how spoiled we are. Mm-hmm. I mean, just the fact not only that he can answer the questions the way that he answers them, I would say there may be other bishops in our country that could answer those questions. The fact that he's willing to do mm-hmm. it, and the fact that he's willing to do it every week, that's unprecedented. I would just mm-hmm. tell you, there's nobody else doing it. And we're so thankful for him. Not only that he's willing to do it, but as I said, that he's capable of doing it and answering questions in such a wide swath. You know, it's amazing. Faith questions, civil questions, civic questions, all that good stuff. So
some people they write to our own bishop. They send from the template on the AnnunciationRadio.com website.
Yeah,
or they just send an email to bishop@AnnunciationRadio.com and they pose their question. They ask their question of Bishop Daniel E. Thomas. Sometimes people actually make a direct request to the Pope, which is kind of interesting, as a 19-year-old recently did.
I just love this quest. This is so fabulous. From Vatican News, Pope requests youngest synod member be excused from classes. Wyatt, you have the name there.
Probably Olivia's.
Olivia's, who is 19 years old and studies at the University of Wyoming, asked Pope Francis to sign a letter excusing him his classes in order to rest after 4 weeks of work at the synod.
That's hilarious. He's got an excuse note from the Pope.
And it's the University of Wyoming. This is not a Catholic college, but he thinks the letter might help him.
Wow. He's a student at the University of Wyoming in Laramie, a missionary at the Catholic Youth Program, Totus Tuus, and a catechist in his home diocese of Cheyenne. And he's leaving Rome Monday, October 30th, supposed to show up in a lecture room, which is a three-hour drive away, potentially with snow on the road as early as Tuesday morning, and half-chokingly, Wyatt decided to draft a letter explaining to his professors that he needed to recover from his work at the Vatican before resuming classes. And who better to have it signed by than the president of the whole assembly? With a smile, the Pope agreed to sign that letter.
Yeah, and he wrote in his tiny handwriting, which is his custom, Francis, this is the letter. This is as great as the story itself. Now, remember, Wyatt wrote this letter. Wyatt Olivius has been, again, this is the content of the letter. Wyatt Olivius has been an integral part of the Synod on Synodality, working diligently to contribute to the significant event in the church. Again, this is Wyatt writing about Wyatt. mm-hmm. His efforts have been greatly appreciated by the church community, and we are grateful for his dedication and hard work. As a result of his tireless efforts, we believe Wyatt deserves a break from his classes to recharge and rejuvenate.
And then the letter continues, Wyatt has pinky promised to return to his classes and complete his work. Yeah. And we trust that he will keep his word. We're confident that after this much needed break, he will return to his studies with renewed energy and focus. Therefore, we kindly request that he be excused from his classes for a short period. Signed, Francis.
Yeah. The Pope smiled as he returned the letter to the young man. Signed, it's true, you are important, Pope Francis told Olivius. Olivius thanked him for inviting him and thus giving a voice also to that group of young people who, as he had mentioned in interviews before the event in Rome, often feel somewhat cut off from the decision-making in the church. I love the whole story. He writes his own letter, and the Pope signs it.
And Holy Father, watch your mailbox. There's a bunch of intermediate students that are looking to get a Friday off.
Right, I'm about to write you a letter myself. I'd like a week off, Holy Father. Hilarious. That is so fabulous.
Fantastic. A big day straight ahead yet. We're going to be chatting with Matthew Archbold, who we spent an hour with yesterday for faithful reasons. We've got Andrew Reinhardt coming up.
Yeah. We've always enjoy taking that deep dive with Andrew Reinhardt about 50 minutes from now.
So hang in there. I'm going to try to stump these two in the studio here with One Doesn't Belong or something coming up.
One Doesn't Belong next.
Hi, this is Judge Mike Goulding from St. Joseph's Church in Maumee. You're listening to Catholic Radio right here in the Diocese of Toledo. This is Annunciation Radio, faith with frequency.
Do you have something you'd like to ask our bishop? Most Reverend Daniel Lee Thomas answers questions from our listeners each and every week on The Bishop's Corner. Send in your questions about the faith, today's cultural trends, diocesan news and events, prayer life, anything on your mind. Click the Bishop's Corner tab at AnnunciationRadio.com or on our app and listen for his answer Thursdays at 4:30 p.m., Fridays at 11, and Saturdays at noon on Annunciation Radio.
Carry the home missions close to your heart by downloading the free Glen Mary Home Missioners mobile app. Glen Mary brings the Catholic faith to rural parts of Appalachia in the South where it is not effectively present. The free Glen Mary app is a one-stop shop to access daily reflections written by missioners, prayer resources, and information about mission in the United States. The app is available for iPhones and Androids. To download, search Glen Mary in your mobile device's app store or visit glenmary.org/app. That's glenmary.org/app.
Hello friends, Peter Ainge here, CEO of Ohio Right to Life, with a critical update for you on voting no on Issue 1 this November. Planned Parenthood and the ACLU are working to pass Issue 1 on November 7th, which would legalize painful abortion up to the moment of birth here in the state of Ohio. It would also eliminate a parent's right to know whether or not their underage child is considering an abortion or even sex change operation. And it would remove basic health and safety standards for women. Time is of the essence, and we need your help. First, please pray with us every day to defeat Issue 1. Second, please visit creativeequal.org/issue1 to learn how you can phone bank from the comfort of your own home or knock on doors to spread the truth about the dangers of Issue 1. Third, please consider supporting us so we can finish strong. Visit ohiolife.org to help today. Thank you so much for your support. And vote no on Issue 1.
Catholic Radio for the Diocese of Toledo. This is Annunciation Radio. WNOC Bowling Green Toledo. WHRQ Sandusky. WRRO Eden Bryant. WFOT Lexington Mansfield. And WSHB Willard.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
And we are back on this Thursday version of Morning Offering with Ron and Dave. We've got which of these? Thursday, I'm sorry.
One doesn't belong.
One doesn't belong. Coming up in just a minute. Real quickly, the headlines. A mass shooting at multiple locations in Lewiston, Maine has left at least 22 people dead and injured as many as 60. Officials say the death toll is expected to rise with the suspect at large as of this writing, late yesterday evening. But I will tell you, as of this morning, at least an hour ago, he was still at large. And so we pray for his capture and the safety of everyone in harm's way right now.
And the Mexican resort town of Acapulco, without power and communications, Hurricane Otis arrived in full force, I think is a Category 5. So flood waters yesterday and a Category 5 storm, Otis, the strongest hurricane to make landfall in the eastern Pacific on record.
Yeah, and it caught everybody by surprise. They were expecting winds of 70 miles per hour and gotten 165.
Ooh, ouch.
Israel has reportedly agreed to delay its anticipated ground invasion of Gaza to allow the U.S. time to deploy air defense systems to protect U.S. troops in the Middle East. U.S. officials are concerned Israel's invasion could cause an uptick in militant groups targeting American forces in the region. At least 13 such attacks have occurred in Syria and Iraq in the past week. Israel hasn't disclosed the timeline of its ground invasion, but said it would delay its plans until at least later this week. We continue our prayers as encouraged by both the Patriarch of Jerusalem, our Holy Father, who's asked for a day of prayer and fasting tomorrow for the protection of all of the innocent civilians.
So mark that down, the 27th day of prayer. Don't forget that. Of course, Wendy will have complete details on those and other stories, including the tentative UAW-Ford agreement that, you know, it, at least is positive signs. And then, of course, the big news out of London, Ohio. You're familiar with London, Ohio.
London, Ohio. Big news out of London, Ohio?
There is.
No, I didn't know that.
Where Jerry Ketron has an inspiration for Halloween decor.
Yeah.
The display, they titled Taylor Stiff Concert, features a skeleton Taylor Swift on stage performing for a crowd of devoted skeleton fans. That's their display in London, Ohio. There are even security guards making sure Travis Kelce does not get on the stage. So there you go. And then, of course, in another display, this one in New York, Heather Nolette of Peru, New York, she and her family are known for their elaborate Halloween decorations. This year decided to go all out in a tribute to their mutual love of Taylor Swift because there's a huge pumpkin.
Yeah.
It's a Swiftie display that they've got that's an animatronic skeleton band, and they've got that. And then there's somebody out there that's got a 400-pound pumpkin that's done up as Taylor Swift. Her face, her makeup,
she
her hair.
She would probably be offended, 400 pounds.
I don't think so. You know? It's a huge, big pumpkin head of Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
And
And thanks for bringing up the Ketron family in London, Ohio. If you've heard of the Hatfields and McCoys, in London, West Jefferson, Ohio, that's the Ketrons and Vacheresses.
Oh, gotcha.
And, yeah, thanks for bringing them attention on my radio show. Now my whole family is going to be upset with me that we've given some attention to the Ketrons of London.
Pumpuses.
Yeah. Isn't that funny, though? I saw a posting on social media yesterday that I thought pretty much summed this up for me. The man said, I have a limited number of days on this earth. Thank you for wasting so many of them telling me about Taylor Swift.
Well, she's going to be out there in full force for Halloween. That's
and that's
sure.
good. Yeah. God bless them. Wonderful stuff. Couldn't be happier for those two individuals. Just good stuff.
Are you ready to kind of tease your brain a little bit?
Let's do it. I am ready. Which of these doesn't belong?
Yeah, one of these doesn't belong. And since today is Pat Sajak's 77th birthday, I want to do this kind of wheel style.
Oh, I like that.
So we're going to figure out which one I'm going to use for you here and see what it. All right, you ready?
There it is. This is the one that came up on the wheel.
This is the one that came up on the wheel. Hammer, toaster, drill, go-kart. And if you want to help Tim and Dave out, you can text what you think it is at 833-598-5959. Which one of those words does not belong? What the others have in common, okay? Hammer, toaster, drill, go-kart.
Hammer, toaster, drill, go-kart. Huh. Heat?
Well.
Heat? You've got a thought on it?
Let's see.
Well, let's see here. So you have...
You drill down.
Well, there's two tools.
Yeah.
A go-kart isn't a tool, though. So, but you have some sort of action with it. You drill, you have to have an action.
Hey, thanks for all the help, our listeners. Yeah,
hammer,
if you've got a
you
thought, maybe,
a...
maybe you come in now.
Hammer, you have to have some sort of action to it, but... Well, toaster, I guess you could pop it down. You have to pop down the button.
You push down on a toaster, you push down on a grill, and you push down
on a hammer.
Well, the go-kart.
It's a downward motion. Go-kart, you don't.
Yeah, you do. The gas pedal.
Well, that's a good point. That's a good point. You have to let go somewhere.
But I'm with you. You use your hands to push, to come down on a hammer. You push the toaster thing down, and you push the drill down. The answer is go-kart does not belong. Thank you to our dear listeners for all your help.
is that it? So hammer, toaster, drill, go-kart. You think go-kart is the word that does not belong.
And
go-kart.
If we're wrong, I know who everybody's going to look to.
Do we agree with not only the answer, but the reasoning behind the answer? Okay,
yes.
You come down on a hammer, you push down on a toaster, you push down on a drill. You do not push down on a go-kart.
That's our final answer. All right. Well, you guys are very smart, but actually you're very wrong.
Oh, my goodness.
Very wrong. The thing is that these things have in common, the toaster, the drill, and the go-kart are all motorized or have to be plugged in, okay?
Okay.
So they're powered.
Okay.
But a hammer is a hand tool.
That's right.
Yeah, that was my other thought.
Well, that's a good time to come up with that other thought.
Yeah. Hey, Dave does it. Dave does it on...
Oh, look at him pushing the blame on you.
Oh, my goodness. I asked you if you agreed with that reasoning. Be
you
a good loser.
Me.
Be a good loser. This is the problem with smart people.
Stay
They're
tuned
right
tomorrow
so
to see how we do
how
without
lose.
Producer Tim.
There we go.
All right,
Love it. All right.
Very good.
Very good.
All right.
Well, that was good.
So it was hammer. Yeah.
Hammer.
A self-powered... piece of equipment where everything else is powered by
when you said else. When you said gas pedal, though, I mean, there is some sort of action to that where you are pushing down on it.
Yeah,
so
it basically destroyed our reasoning, and yet we went with it anyway. And again, thanks to all the listeners who were so kind. And I'm sure now they're saying, yeah, I told you. I was trying to tell you. Like, yeah, you got to get in there earlier. Thank you very much.
Okay, so you can blame Pat Sajak.
Yeah, there you go. Thanks, Pat. Fun. Happy birthday, Pat.
Happy birthday.
Spinning the wheel.
Oh, jeez.
Yep. So that's a look at today's one doesn't belong, and now we know why.
Yep.
There not as go. Easy as it seems.
You know? That one was, it could have gone a couple different ways, but at the end of the day, the one that was right actually makes the most sense. Mm-hmm. Toasters powered by drill, powered by go-kart, powered by hammer, self-propelled. I mean, that's human strength. That's it.
Okay.
Very good.
Well, you gave it the old college try.
Yeah. What's the gun?
Well, I didn't say air hammer.
Yeah. Okay. Air hammer would be. Yeah. There we go.
But yeah, you
now could, I was thinking the nail hair.
I was listening to MC Hammer at a volleyball game the other night. And,
well, he's powered by Red Bull.
Yeah.
You've had Red Bull when and MC
those wide
Hammer
pants,
was
like, know, bam. Man. Like, he looks like he's a flower going across the stage with those wide pants. Just fabulous.
You've got parachute pants at home, don't you?
Oh, of course. Yeah.
All I can hear him say is, stop, hammer time.
Yeah, hammer time. All right.
I have an idea. It's prayer time.
Yeah, I would say so.
Lord Jesus Christ, in union with that divine intention with which you offered to God your praises on earth through your most sacred heart, and now offer them in the sacrament of the Eucharist everywhere, even to the end of time. I most gladly offer you throughout this entire day all my thoughts and intentions, all my affections and desires, all my words and deeds, in imitation of the most holy heart of the Blessed Virgin Mary Immaculate. Amen.
Amen. And we continue our prayer as we join parents of priests and pray for our clergy and religious. We pray for vocations and for an increase of faith so as to become a more holy diocese of Toledo. Today we pray for seminarian Mr. Declan Reamer.
Dear Lord, we pray that the Blessed Mother wrap her mantle around your priests to follow her own words, do whatever he tells you. May your priests have the heart of St. Joseph, Mary's most chaste spouse. May the Blessed Mother's own pierced heart inspire them to embrace all who suffer at the foot of the cross. May your priest be holy, filled with the fire of your love, seeking nothing but your greater glory and the salvation of souls. Amen. St. John Vianney,
pray for us. And now we pray a Hail Mary for an increase of vocations in the Diocese of Toledo, as we've been encouraged to do by Bishop Thomas. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And our word for today on this Thursday of the 29th week in Ordinary Time, this Thursday, October the 26th, our word for today is division. Division is our word for today. Our reading, we continue in St. Paul's letter to the Romans, now chapter 6. Brothers and sisters, I am speaking in human terms because of the weakness of your nature. For just as you presented the parts of your bodies as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness for lawlessness, so now present them as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free from righteousness. But what profit did you get then from the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit that you have leads to sanctification, and its end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Our responsorial psalm, Psalm number 1, blessed are they who hope in the Lord. Blessed the man who follows not the counsel of the wicked, nor walks in the way of sinners, nor sits in the company of the insolent, but delights in the law of the Lord and meditates on his law day and night. He is like a tree planted near running water that yields its fruit in due season and whose leaves never fade. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked, not so. They are like chaff which the wind drives away. For the Lord watches over the way of the just, but the way of the wicked vanishes.
Alleluia, alleluia. I consider all things so much rubbish that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Alleluia, alleluia. Our Holy Gospel is from Luke today. Jesus said to his disciples, I have come to set the earth on fire, and how I wish it were already blazing. There is a baptism with which I must be baptized, and how great is my anguish until it is accomplished. Do you think that I have come to establish peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. From now on, a household of five will be divided, three against two and two against three. A father will be divided against his son, and a son against his father. A mother against her daughter, and a daughter against her mother. A mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law.
And our word for today, division. Division, our word for today. Our Holy Father's thoughts regarding today's gospel reading, these he shared at his Angelus address on August the 18th, 2013. Jesus says to his disciples, Do you think that I have come to give peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. What does this mean? It means that faith is not a decorative or ornamental element. Living faith does not mean decorating life with a little religion as if it were a cake and we were decorating it with cream. No, this is not faith. Faith means choosing God as the criterion and basis of life, and God is not empty. God is not neutral. God is always positive. God is love, and love is positive. After Jesus has come into the world, it is impossible to act as if we do not know God or as if he were something that is abstract, empty, a purely nominal reference. No, God has a real face. He has a name. God is mercy. God is faithfulness. He is life, which is given to us all. For this reason, Jesus says, I came to bring division. It is not that Jesus wishes to split people up. On the contrary, Jesus is our peace. He is our reconciliation. But this peace is not the peace of the tomb. It is not neutrality. Jesus does not bring neutrality. This peace is not a compromise at all costs. Following Jesus entails giving up evil and selfishness and choosing good, truth and justice, even when this demands sacrifice and the renunciation of our own interests. And this indeed divides, as we know. It even cuts the closest ties. This indeed divides, as we know. It even cuts the closest ties. Division, our word for today. I want to go first to St. Paul's letter to the Romans, to a particular verse there. But what profit did you get then from the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. For what profit did you get then from the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. Those of us who have come into relationship with the Lord understand that what we participated in before, even the things that we've done since we've come into relationship with Christ, are things that we should be ashamed of, things that we should be sorry for, things that we should have a purpose of an amendment for, to amend our lives and to head into a different direction. We are the sons and daughters of God. Through baptism, we have become members of his family, and so we belong to him. And we're aware of the shame that should follow an act that is contradicts the very life that he has called us to. But what profit did you get then from the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. Since we have that understanding that those things lead to death, and we have been made free by the cross of Jesus Christ, by his laying his own life down in so that we might be reconciled to the Father, by an act of his own will, choosing to do that out of love for us, and the Father sending his Son Jesus into the world to die for us out of love for us. Yes, we feel that shame because of the things that we do that are opposite of what the Lord has called us to. And brothers and sisters, the beginning of that verse, what profit did you get then from the things of which you are now ashamed? The answer is none. There is no profit in sin. Sin is death, for the end of those things is death. Later in this reading, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So since we've come to this understanding that those things that are contradictory to the life of Christ bring shame and death upon us, and we have given ourselves over to this newness of life by grace, then we have to understand that those who are not living that way of life are not profiting from it. No matter what our eyes might tell us, no matter what face they may put on, they are living in death. They are victims of the evil one. And so our heart is for them. And yes, there is division, but the division does not come from us. As the Holy Father says, we just simply live out the truth. And those who object to the truth, there is a division in those two things, but not because that's what we desire. No, we desire love and forgiveness and mercy. But we cannot remove ourselves from proclaiming the truth. Following Jesus entails giving up evil and selfishness, our Holy Father says, and choosing good, truth, and justice, even when this demands sacrifice and the renunciation of our own interest. And this indeed divides, as we know, it even cuts the closest of ties. I am going to use this opportunity to put forward a challenge to every one of you, including us here. There is a way that you can mark yourself as a believer right now as we head toward these votes in November. And I would liken it to an Old Testament story about the Passover, when the firstborn of all the Egyptians was taken and the Israelites were instructed to put the blood of the lamb on their doorposts so that the angel of death would pass over. And if they did not put the blood of the lamb on their doorposts, their firstborn would be taken as well. We have an opportunity, as Joshua says, we have been set before us life and death, blessing and a curse. Choose life then that you might live. Again, it has been set before us, life and death, blessing and a curse. Choose life then that you might live. I don't think I'm talking to any of you or encouraging any of you in a different direction other than choosing no on issue one in November for the protection of the unborn and the protection of parental rights. So if I have to convince you of that, we'd have to start at a different place. But what I would like to challenge you with, brothers and sisters, is put a sign in your yard. Put a sign in your window. Get one of these yard signs and display it somewhere so that others know that you have marked your home. You have said, I choose life. I choose the blessing that is life. And this is that external sign. And you might say, well, the Lord doesn't require external sign. Yeah, he does. Sometimes he actually does. And we get to actually participate in that by choosing to do that. How many were afraid to put that blood on their doorpost because then they would be recognized as true followers of the one true God? Some probably didn't, and their firstborn died that night. So we are called. Now, I'm not saying thus saith the Lord. I am saying thus saith Dave. I'm encouraging you to make that stand, to put a sign in your yard. You don't know how that's going to affect those around you. If you need a sign, you can call us, and we have signs here. And if you can't come get them here, I will deliver them to you. I will make sure if you want a sign that you have a sign. Either myself or someone else who has these signs will make sure you get it. And I'm going to encourage you to make that commitment and actually do it, to put the sign in your yard that says, I choose life. I choose the blessing. I reject the curse. And I want that marking in my yard, on my house, whatever it is that you can do. If you don't have, if you're renting and you have an apartment, put it in your window. Find some place to put this sign and mark yourself in this clear way as standing for life. Could it cause division? It certainly could. But it's not because you're doing something bad that brings about the division. It's because you are doing something good, and the demons that are stirring up other people to be on the opposite side are irritated by that good. Mm-hmm. That's the division, when we irritate the demons that are around us. Now, again, the people participating are victims, but the evil one has his plan. And his plan does not include you putting a sign standing for life in your yard, I can tell you that. So if you want a sign, call us here at the office. We will get you a sign, or you can come pick one up here, 419-868-2966, 419-868-2966. Again, as our Holy Father says, following Jesus entails giving up evil and selfishness and choosing good, truth and justice, even when this demands sacrifice and the renunciation of our own interests. And this indeed divides, as we know. It even cuts the closest ties. Division, our word for today.
Wow, that's a great illustration of how division doesn't always come from a bad place. I mean, it comes from a good place. That's what causes the division.
Yeah, and we can't help but do good.
Putting that sign up or putting it in your window.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're making a statement. You're standing for life, as you said.
And encourage others to do it, too. If you already have a sign in your yard, encourage someone else to do it. But if you want one, 419-868-2966, and we will get you a sign.
And we could arrange free installation.
Oh, absolutely. We could put it in your yard for you.
That's
for
right.
Sure.
Thank you, Dave. And Andrew Reinhardt with his take on today's Word of the Day.
Looking forward to that.
It'll be coming up in about a half an hour. And we get to find out what's on the mind of Matthew Archbold right after we hear what's on the news desk of Wendy Sheridan.
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan. A public meeting tonight to talk about a possible apartment complex in South Toledo. The development is called The Glen. It would bring a 50-unit building to Glendale and Byrne as part of the Southland Shopping Plaza. In the past, neighbors have taken issue with a potential project, saying they'd prefer to see businesses there. The meeting is tonight at the Heather Downs Branch Library. Metro Parks Toledo will soon add a new inclusive playground. Board members voted unanimously to add ADA-compliant equipment at Ravine Park. The price tag, a little more than $88,000. The area will be renamed the Ravine Area of Glass City Metro Park. A deadly mass shooting shocked the state of Maine last night. Authorities say a gunman shot dozens of people, many fatally, in multiple locations in Lewiston, Maine. A state police bulletin said a man identified as a person of interest is a firearms instructor trained by the military and was recently committed to a mental health facility. The United Nations warns it is close to running out of fuel in the Gaza Strip. The UN says that would force it to sharply scale back relief efforts in the territory devastated by Israeli airstrikes. That happened since Hamas's gruesome attack on Israel on October 7th. In Washington, D.C., Republicans finally came together to elect a Speaker of the House. Mike Johnson, a lawmaker from Louisiana, garnered the required 217 votes to take the gavel, something three other nominees failed to do after Kevin McCarthy was ousted from the Speaker position. The United Auto Workers and Ford have reached a tentative deal 6 weeks into the auto workers' strike. The agreement must be voted on and approved by Ford's more than 50,000 UAW employees. It includes a 25% wage increase over the next 4 years and better retirement benefits. The other two automakers, General Motors and Stellantis, are also continuing to work towards agreements with the unions. This week, Apple is raising the price of its subscription rates for Apple TV Plus and other services. Apple TV Plus subscribers will now pay $9.99 a month, $3 more than the previous price. This is the second price hike for Apple TV Plus since its 2019 launch. The price of Halloween candy is downright scary. Candy prices are up 7.5% compared to last year. Americans are expected to spend $3.6 billion on Halloween candy this year. That's about $32 per person. From the WTOL 11 Weather Center, cloudy 75 today, sunny 77 tomorrow. Clouds return 66 for Saturday. More seasonable temperatures are coming our way next week. in the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio. I'm Wendy Sheridan.
Thanks, Wendy. 64 degrees right now. Beautiful day.
Absolutely, and a perfect time for a wonderful conversation with the one, the only, Matthew Archbold.
Oh, let's get right to his mind and dig deep and find out what's on his mind today.
Good morning, Matthew.
I am doing very well, but I have nothing to share. I've shared everything with you people.
What a show yesterday on Faith with Reason. So,
yes. Hey. I'm empty. That's it. I got nothing left.
Let me ask you this, Matthew. What's going on?
You know, right now I'm
what
in
you
a
been
very,
up to?
That's funny.
Yeah. I loved the show yesterday. That was my favorite part, actually. Yeah, good stuff.
I wondered if I stepped too far.
No. You know,
sometimes I forget, like Shane. I've spoken to him a few times in my life. I've never met the man. You know what I mean? And mm-hmm. here I am going right after him. Then later I was like, I wonder if he's okay with that. But he seemed like a good sport.
Oh, he's perfectly yes, he built for it. Yeah, it's good.
Right now, I do want to say, I hate to talk about myself and all, but this is a very dangerous time of year for me.
Oh.
Yes. My wife has bought a lot of Halloween candy.
Mm.
And it's just sitting here. And all, you know, I'm staring at it and I'm just thinking, do these kids really need all this candy?
Mm.
You know? I don't even know them all that well. There's kids in the neighborhood. You know what I mean? Like, a little less might help them. You know, some of them don't look like they're in great shape. You know what I mean?
Let me take a look at you. I got to decide whether you're getting candy or an apple.
Right. And this whole trick-or-treat thing, it's sort of a threat. You know, and I don't negotiate with terrorists. So, you know, I'm thinking it might be better if I just, partake in the candy myself.
I think that's perfect. That's wonderful. And I like the idea of putting a scale on the porch and the candy they get.
Yeah, there you go.
It depends on the reading on the scale, right?
Georgie, here's a salad. Sarah, you get a Snickers. All good.
That's right. That's right. Have a BMI index going on. The kids will be complaining. Oh, no, it's all the costume. It's weighing me down, you know?
That's right.
It's a very heavy costume.
You get a lot of trick-or-treaters?
We do, actually. We went through it goes in waves, but the last few years we've had quite a bit, which I love. I love Halloween. I love sitting. So I get every year since we bought the house, which is now 25 years ago, we have a big bonfire going in the front, on the front. I dress up as Fred Flintstone, same costume.
I love
my
it.
My entire adult
I
life.
I love it. I love it.
Yeah. All right, Matthew, I want to tap into your scriptural knowledge and just your deep understanding of the Christian Catholic faith and take you to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 to 17. But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty, for people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power, avoid such people. Are we at the end, the last days? I'm based on that and your deep understanding of the scriptures, have we hit that place where we are living life upside down?
That sounds like my kids. I got to be honest.
That descript is of your kids, you're saying.
Right. Unappeasable, irate all the time. Yeah, that's pretty much them. You know, I think we have gotten to a point where we cannot get ourselves out of this trouble.
Mm-hmm.
I think we've reached that point of no return inside the church, outside of the church. But here's the thing. This has been on my mind lately. The way God works, we can't even understand it. It works in such mysterious ways. And one of the things I love about the Catholic faith is that we just acknowledge mysteries. We don't try to explain it away. We don't try to rationalize everything. You know, I love that about Catholicism, that we can't know the mind of God. We can't know the way of reality beyond our own senses. And God works in such mysterious ways. You know, some of the greatest endorsements of Christianity are through the anti-Christian early sentiment.
Mm-hmm.
Early on, we've discovered in the first century, graffiti. They call it the Alexamanos graffiti because the Romans were making fun of some Roman soldier who had adopted Christianity, and they are making fun of him. And it says Alexamanos worshiping his god, and he's looking up at the cross, someone on the cross.
Mm. In the first century.
Yes, and so people say, the fact that Jesus was God, that was something later on. No, it wasn't, because we have an anti-Christian graffiti showing that Christians believe this to be God. Mm. We also have a letter from someone named Celsus written in the early second century, and he attempts to explain away the virgin birth, right? Now, so we now know for sure that this was not something added on later.
Mm.
And he admits Jesus' miracles. He said, that time he spent in Egypt, he must have, learned to do all these weird tricks. Mm. So they don't say, no, that none of that happened. None of that happened. Mm. They try to explain it away.
Mm.
Even the time of Jesus on the cross, you have writings at the time of people trying to explain that it was an eclipse.
Mm.
They don't say it didn't happen.
Right.
Mm. They explain it away. So God is working right now, and he's working in ways we're not going to understand. So in short, I'm sorry, the answer to your question is, we might be.
That's a good answer.
We are heading into a very, very dark time, and I think we need God to really rev up those mysterious ways right now, because we need it.
But I love this. We've gotten to a point where we cannot get ourselves out of the trouble.
You know, thank you, Matthew.
We need God.
God bless
you. This is Rodney Schuster, Executive Director of Catholic Charities in the Diocese of Toledo. Join me each week on Annunciation Radio for Faith Alive, as we highlight the many ministries and services Catholic Charities provides, Tuesday at 4 p.m. and Saturdays at 3 p.m. on Annunciation Radio.
The Catholic Church teaches that Jesus Christ is literally and wholly present, body and blood, soul and divinity, under the appearances of bread and wine. St. John the Apostle records the John chapter 6 Bread of Life discourse, in which Jesus states that his flesh is true food and his blood true drink. Who better to understand John's writings and subsequent teachings than a disciple and student of John, St. Ignatius of Antioch? In his letter to the Smyrnians in 110 AD, Ignatius writes, "I have no taste for corruptible food, nor for the pleasures of this life. I desire the bread of God, which is the flesh of Jesus Christ. And for drink, I desire his blood, which is love incorruptible." The Catholic Church absolutely follows St. John and St. Ignatius in taking Jesus at his word. Examining the truths of the Catholic faith, this is faithforensics.org.
This is Father Philip Smith, Director of Vocations for the Diocese of Toledo, and I would invite you to join me in praying a prayer for priestly vocations. Lord God, in your plan for our salvation, you provide shepherds for your people. Fill the hearts of young people in the Diocese of Toledo with courage and love. Raise up worthy ministers for your altars. Make them ardent yet gentle servants of the gospel. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Underwriting support on Annunciation Radio is provided by Isabel Financial Services, 2346 North Reynolds Road in Toledo, 419-535-1236. Online at isabelfinancialservices.com.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
And we are back. It's Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on this Thursday. Love, Matthew Archibald. If you didn't get a chance to hear Faith with Reasons yesterday, it is now posted, right, on website and
app.
Yeah, it is,
and it'll air at 10 o'clock on Saturday morning.
Yeah,
too,
so take a listen. That was a fabulous look. We always enjoy Matthew. That was an extended conversation with him yesterday on Faith with Reasons from 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. every Wednesday. But he was your guest, Ron, and I thought the conversation that ensued was absolutely fabulous.
And we did not touch too much on creativeminorityreport.com, but I certainly encourage people to check that out. That's a daily read. I mean, you get in there he doesn't lose a sense of humor, but there's some very serious topics that are brought forward.
And he freshens it every day. I mean, you have new stories every day.
That's right,
that is one that should be checked out every day. Hey, something we like to check out around here every day is a little something called Bet You Didn't Know That. I Know I Didn't. And all about Slinkies today.
Slinkies.
Slinky. I don't know. I don't remember their song about Slinky.
I remember that part of it.
Yeah. Was that part of the Slinky song?
Yeah.
Okay. Here we go. Each Slinky contains 67 feet of flat steel wire and weighs approximately a half a pound. If you stretch a standard Slinky out flat, it would measure 87 feet long.
Wow.
Yeah. Now, I didn't realize it weighed a half a pound. Honestly, I could have worked out with the Slinky even in high school.
That's right, yeah.
I could have just had one in each hand. How about this? During the Vietnam War, Slinkies were used. Now, this part I did not know. During the Vietnam War, Slinkies were used as mobile antennas. If you use a Slinky as an antenna, it receives at a frequency between 7 and 8 megahertz.
Wow.
So troops in the Vietnam War used them as impromptu radio antennas. Soldiers would clip the ends of the Slinkies onto radios and run the other end up a tree or toss it over a high branch.
Neat idea.
Now, you could see that working, right? And so you get this Slinky that's kind of going over stuff, or say you've got you want to go to a high place, you put the Slinky up there, and then you've got the radio down on the ground, and the Slinky is giving you that up to 67 feet of flat wire.
Wow.
So there you go. The more you stretch it out. In 2001, the Slinky became the official toy of the state of Pennsylvania, the same year that its inventor, Richard T. James, a graduate of Penn State, and his wife were inducted into the National Toy Hall of Fame. 300 million Slinkies have been sold, enough to circle the earth 150 times if stretched out. And the same as it goes at Penn State. Yeah, our football team may not be much, but we have the Slinky.
That's right.
And then here's the other thing. And I want you guys to say it with me. I've got it on your paper, too.
Okay.
Ready? And Tim and I will share one. Ready? On three. One, two, three.
Pogo stick. Pogo stick. Pogo stick.
It's still not in the Toy Hall of Fame. It's crazy.
It's an outrage.
I'm going to be the official fan base for the Pogo stick getting into the Hall of Fame. I love Slinky, and it definitely deserves to be there.
Mm-hmm.
But my buddy Pogo Stick deserves to be there, too.
I think if we get a 19-year-old to write a letter to the Pope and have him sign it and send it to the Hall.
But he'd have to be pictured on a Pogo Stick.
That would add some gravitas. But you can go online to vote for the Pogo Stick.
Oh, okay,
so
that's still open.
I encourage you to do that.
Do that.
You could do that once per day, and you might push him over the top.
There you go. There you go. I like it. There's a little, I bet you didn't know that. I know I didn't. And now for Heroes of the Faith. And you say, how in the world can you go from such levity to such a serious topic? Well, we do it all the time.
Yeah, that's right. We certainly do. It's what makes the world go round.
That's right.
And I don't know. This is a very long name.
Okay.
Of today's Hero of the Faith. It's Blessed Jose Gregorio Hernandez Cisneros.
My goodness. But none of them complicated, but not as complicated.
His memorial is today, the 26th of October. It used to be the 29th of June, but they changed it so it wouldn't conflict with the Solemnity of Saints Peter and Paul celebrated on June 29th. But anyway, Jose was the eldest of six children born to Benigno Maria Hernandez Manzanita and Josefa Antonia Cisneros Mancilla. So apparently he comes from a long line of long names, apparently. But he was baptized in January of 1865, confirmed in December of 1867. And beginning at age 18, he studied medicine at the University of Caracas, Venezuela, graduating in June of 1888. Then in Paris, France, and Berlin, Germany, he felt he was called to religious life, so Jose joined the secular Franciscans in December of 1899 and started investigating becoming a Carthusian monk. After some theology studies in Rome, Italy, he was forced to return to Caracas for health reasons. Jose took this as a sign that he should give up the idea of religious life and serve as an apostolate and as a physician. So that's how he spent the rest of his life, single, celibate, prayerful, and dedicated to caring for the poor for free.
Wow.
So he...
As a physician.
Yes, as a physician. He was born October 26, 1864, in Esnotu, Trujillo, Venezuela. He died in June 29th of 1919 in Caracas, Venezuela, by being hit by a car while delivering medications that he purchased for an elderly patient.
Mm.
Yeah, he was venerated by Pope John Paul II with a decree of heroic virtues on January 16th, 1986, and beatified in 2021 by Pope Francis with the celebration at the Universidad Central de Venezuela, Caracas, Venezuela, Apostolic Nuncio Aido Gordano presiding. Now, his beatification miracle involving the healing of a 10-year-old girl in the Diocese of San Fernando in Venezuela who'd been shot in the head with a shotgun during an armed robbery in March of 2017. She was badly injured, pellets in her brain. Because there was a delay in obtaining a neurosurgeon, her mother began to pray for the intercession of then-venerable Jose Gregorio. The girl improved, the surgery was canceled, and she was released just a few days later in good health.
Oh, my goodness.
Quite a beatification miracle.
Boy, that one definitely confirms, right, to get that kind of miracle. And that's what it takes, is one that can't be explained by medical science. And love that. Sure. And I love his vocation was a physician. We often think, well, the highest calling is religious life. No, the Lord had a higher calling for him
certainly
personally,
did, yeah.
Serving the poor.
So blessed Jose Gregorio Hernandez Cisneros.
Pray for us. Love it. Thank you, Ron.
Welcome to Catechism for Today with Father Nicholas Weibel. Lessons for daily life from the Catechism of the Catholic Church.
Occasionally, I meet someone who seems to have a secret, some special knowledge that sets a person apart. Such a person was Ruby Free. I met her when she was conducting a Holy Land tour. She must have a secret, I said to myself enviously. How else can she accomplish so much so easily? She was a good listener, a troubleshooter, an organizer, a mother hen to all 72 of us, plus her own two children. Yet she was never tired, never out of sorts. Then back home, I visited Ruby. I think I discovered her secret. There it was, a two-word motto over her sink. Yes, Lord. What does the Catechism say about this? Paragraph 1899. The authority required by the moral order derives from God. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, he who resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. Those who resist will incur judgment. Romans 13:1-2. And paragraph 2609. Once committed to conversion, the heart learns to pray in faith. Faith is a filial adherence to God beyond what we feel and understand. It is possible because the beloved Son gives us access to the Father. He can ask us to seek and to knock, since he himself is a door and the way. And Jesus prays to the Father, gives thanks before receiving his gifts, so he teaches us filial boldness. Whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you receive it, and you will. Paragraph 2610. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Hey, if you're coming in to get a sign, I'll give you the address. We share a building with Camelot Salon in Holland, Ohio.
Mm-hmm.
7409 International Drive, right off Airport Highway in Holland. Very, very well-established area, easy to find. We're right off Airport Highway again, and we share a building with Camelot Salon.
Mm-hmm.
Why do I bring that up? Because when you bring your sign, bring a Christmas gift too, because Camelot Salon is partnering with Channel 13 with Hope for the Holidays. So bring a wrapped wait a minute.
Unwrapped.
Unwrapped toy or donation, but let's look at unwrapped toys, new toys, to Camelot Salon. Drop that off, and we'll give that to Camelot Salon, and they'll then give it to Channel 13 for their Hope for Holidays, and you can pick up a sign.
And this is something they do every year.
Yeah, and so they get massive amounts of toys.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, yeah, bring it in and let them know Annunciation Radio told you to bring it or encourage you to bring it. Camelot Salon Toy Drive, Hope for the Holidays.
Yeah, I mean, you could put them right in the bin in the lobby.
Yeah,
We want you to give them to us because so we have an opportunity to play with them first.
Yeah, right.
And then we put them.
Especially the poppers. The ones that roll along, pop, 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 pop. And maybe even a toy vacuum cleaner because whoever's going to do the actual vacuuming, one of us could go alongside with that.
Pogo sticks, welcome.
Pogo sticks, of course. Yeah, always welcome. Hey, Ron, what's going on?
Well, it's a wonderful event coming up in just a couple of days. On Saturday, the annual Mass for Life and Eucharistic Procession starting at St. Catherine of Siena on North Haven at 9 a.m. It's Mass for Life celebrated by Bishop Thomas, who after Mass will lead a Eucharistic procession down the street to the last remaining abortion center. Procession to and from the center will be about a mile and a half and features songs led by Nick De La Torre. And there'll be police presence to ensure safety, block off the streets so you don't have cross traffic.
Yeah.
Because you're passing, probably about four or five cross streets.
Yeah.
You know, so you want to make sure that.
Behind Jesus. Yeah, but there'll be escorts and all that.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
The traffic will be stopped, but the procession will not be stopped.
That's right. Unimpeded. And it's a walk right down to the abortion center and a wonderful opportunity to pray for life.
When you talk about putting feet to your faith, that
absolutely.
One's as good as it gets.
So looking forward to that and looking forward to a lot of stuff next week as well, which we'll get into as we go. But I know Saturday, November 4th, there's several things. Sunday, there's a festival, a parish festival on November the 5th. And then we've got the Holy Mass for the Defeat of Issue 1 at St. Francis de Sales Chapel downtown on Cherry Street on Monday, November 6th. Bishop Daniel Thomas will celebrate at 12:05.
Yeah, so lots of opportunities to participate. And I do want to say this. We've gotten some reaction for those signs. Here is the telephone number again. If you would like a sign, you can come by and get it, or we'll bring it to you if you can't make your way here. 419-868-2966. 419-868-2966. There are definitely other folks out there willing to bring signs. We can coordinate with them. But give us a call here and we can get that coordinated for you. Get a sign in your yard, in your window, please. 419-868-2966. And our word for today on this Thursday of the 29th week in Ordinary Time, this Thursday, October the 26th, our word for today is division. And here to talk about it, the one, the only, Andrew Reinhardt, about to take us on a deep dive. Good morning, Andrew.
Good morning, Andrew.
Good morning, Dave and Ron. How are you?
Doing great. How are you?
Doing great. Doing great. Calling in today from the beautiful St. Joseph Retreat and Conference Center in the Diocese of Lafayette in Indiana.
Oh, my goodness. Fabulous.
Wow.
Yeah. Here for a conference with other diocesan leaders looking at planning collaborative models for parishes, learning from each other's experiences, and trying to help work the renewal of the church. So it's been a blessing.
Wonderful.
Now, on the flip side, you all have to promise to pray for poor Brittany, who the saint has been taking care of our two children by herself for the last couple of days.
All right, prayers for her especially.
Yeah, our word for the day is division. This is from our gospel, and this is one of the hardest gospels, right? Because who doesn't value their family, their mother, their father, their brother, their sister? Like, this is at the core of our humanity, right? And Jesus is saying that as a result of what he's doing, he wants to bring this fire to the earth, and there's going to be this division that's a result of it. So when we read this, we have to remember a few things about the context it is written in. Right? Jesus is talking to a congregation that's going to be converts. They're going to be converting away from whatever the Roman paganism or the Jewish faith or whatever sect or religion that they've been a part of into belief in him, right? So in that context, we have to understand that the center of gravity of our life shifts when we give our life to the Lord. Our center of gravity shifts from whatever we're clinging to in the world, good or bad, on to Jesus. And the beautiful thing is everything good that we had in the world, we find again in Christ, but redeemed, restored, renewed. Right? And so oftentimes our context is different because many times we have the blessing that our family is connected with Christ with us.
Right.
So this is the thing is our connection in Christ with one another is stronger than our natural connections of family, of friendship, of relationship. And so oftentimes, you know, Christians don't experience this in our world today because we have the beautiful value of being in a culture that has historically been Christian. So sometimes we have our natural relationships that are actually strengthened by our faith. But this is becoming less and less the case. You know, I was in seminary for 4 years, and I remember I had friends who were converts and had decided to become priests, and sometimes their parents would take away their vehicles, stop supporting them financially.
Oh, like my goodness. They
were in these real situations where following the Lord's call really separated them from their loved ones. You know, when we think about this reading, I think we go back to the one time in the Old Testament where we see the world on fire, where we see this blaze break through, and that's the story of Moses. Right? You had the chosen people. They had gone down to Egypt. They'd kind of grafted themselves to the Egyptians for their safety and security. But in that context, we have to understand that that wasn't really a good thing through the lens of the scriptures, because they were supposed to turn to the Lord for their safety and security. And so they're slowly losing their identity. They're becoming, in a sense, secularized or Egyptianized by being down there. And so Moses, right, he encountered this burning bush, and his mother and his father were the Pharaoh and the queen, one of the queens of Egypt. And his brother were the other princes of Egypt. You know, in order to follow the Lord, he really had to separate from his family. And he had to be grafted onto this family of faith that the Lord was really in his heritage, in his deepest identity. But this was as a result of the people turning toward the tyrannical regime in Egypt in order to gain their security, in order to gain their sustenance. Right? And this is what's happening in our world today. We're more and more turning toward power and the money of the world and the mindset of the world in order for our basic human needs to be taken care of, right? Secularism. And so as this is happening, more and more believers are going to have to turn away from the things of the world and oftentimes their relationships in order to truly follow the Lord. So there's a prophetic quality to this scripture too. You know, it meant something to the people that heard it, and it meant something to our ancestors and something to us now, but it also means something about our future. So our word for the day is division.
Yeah, I love this. And to your point, this is from St. Padre Pio. Blessed is the crisis that made you grow, the fall that made you gaze up to heaven, the problem that made you look for God. You know, that fire sometimes, Andrew, is exactly, not sometimes, it is what we need in order to fix our gaze on the Lord and stop putting our trust, committing idolatry, quite frankly, in putting our trust in anyone other than God.
Amen. Amen. And that fire, right, is fiery. Because our natural instinct is it's going to burn us, right?
Right.
You know, when Teresa of Avila encountered this fire in her mystical experiences, she talked about like a flaming sword. And as it entered her, it both cauterized the wound, but then also wounded her more deeply. Right. So our encounter with the Lord both heals us, but then also continues to wound us and in a sense, turn that heart to stone into a heart of flesh. But it really is a good analogy is like a surgical process, you know, where there needs to be some additional damage done in order to get deep enough to have the necessary transformation of heart and mind.
Yeah, I love that idea. I mean, that brings clarity to it. Sometimes damage has to be done in order for healing to come about. That's hard for us to understand when we're looking at our world. We don't want to go through the pain, but sometimes it's necessary.
Especially when we're going through it.
Amen. Ourselves. Yeah.
Amen. Wonderful, Andrew. Enjoy the rest of your time, and I'm sure you know, the kids are really behaving nicely.
I don't know. I got them back this afternoon, so we'll see.
All right. Well, thanks for taking the time. We appreciate it.
praying not only for Andrew's time there in the Diocese of Lafayette, but also praying for Brittany, for Maria, and for Solanus, mm-hmm. all at home, enjoying their time together, I'm sure.
Teresa Tomeo coming up in just a few minutes. We'll be back, God willing, tomorrow morning for the Friday morning offering. We're Ron and Dave here on Annunciation Radio. Thanks for listening.